to welcome everybody to the July 21st, 2015 meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell. I'm the chair of the commission and also the counselor for Ward 3. And I note the presence of the quorum, so I'll call the meeting to order. And the first order of business will be the announcement of audio and video recording. And let's begin, as we always do, by introducing ourselves for the benefit of the public, starting with our vice chair.
I'm Lisa Klein, the Ward 7 City Councilor.
James Lowenthal, citizen member and member of the Bicycle and Pedestrian Subcommittee.
Ned Huntley, Public Works Director.
Dave Pomerantz, Director of Central Services.
Krista Gerdet, citizen on Elm Street.
John Carlos, Captain Northampton Police.
Nancy Forrestal, Parking Enforcement Administrator.
Gary Hartwell, citizen.
Okay. And we'll begin now, as we always do, with a period of public comment. Just to give a quick explanation, it's a time for members of the public to speak on any issue. We ask to keep it to about 3 minutes long, especially because I know there's a large number of people here today. And it's sometimes the case, actually often the case, that residents will come with specific requests, and it's less frequently the case that they leave with their requests completely satisfied with the answer. Usually it takes some time, so you should know that I, as chair, or other members of the commission will follow up with you after you have stated your issue. Members of the commission can ask questions, but it's not a time for back and forth between us generally. We also note that if you're here for a specific agenda item, perhaps there are some people from Pine Brook Curve, I don't know, but just maybe there are a few.
Pine's Edge Drive.
If you're here for an item, for example, the traffic calming application for Pine's Edge, then you can wait for that item if you would. Otherwise, starting with no one in particular, if anyone wants to speak, sir, please, if you set your name and address for the record, if you would. Thank you.
My name is Sean Norton. I live on 15 Ravel Avenue. And I appreciate the opportunity to share my concerns and thank my city councilor, Dino Luis, CR, and all of you for your work. I just wanted to share my concerns about one particular area of South Street. I had to get bicycled around town to get around due to health concerns. It's not safe for me to drive. And about half the time when I go along this particular section of South Street approaching the Academy of Music, the bike lane is interfered with by vehicles. During the past, in fact, coming here just for this meeting now, there was a car impeding me in the bike lane there. There's a point when you're approaching the Academy of Music when it's legal for cars to slip in to take the right-hand turn onto Main Street. There's a considerable stretch when there's only one lane for driving and a very clear bike lane. And I would say about 50% of the time in general, and during certain times of day, almost 100% of the time, that bike lane is interfered with. I've had an Ernie's tow truck beeping at me to get out of the way. Other days when there's been a vehicle that tried to use that lane, cutting in early, and was, because there's not really enough room for two cars there, get stuck because there's other cars in the property. The worst incident was which initiated me making contact with my city councilor, was getting knocked over a few weeks ago by a car that cut in and knocked me over and then didn't stop. And I'm reasonably certain, I don't know, 100% certain that she saw what happened and left. And so I fortunately was not badly hurt, but I recognize that this is a very problematic intersection in general. There's been some tragedy there, and there's an effort going on to rework that whole intersection. So I know this is not something that can be done overnight. From my experience as a biker, when those barrels were there, it was a time of safety when I knew that that lane would be open and nobody would be cutting in front of me because cars could not cut in until they got to the legal place to do so. So I miss those barrels. I recognize that they were inconvenient, probably possibly not safe for other reasons. So I know there's a bigger picture here, but I just wanted to share my concerns. And thank you all for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Gordon. Are there any questions? Okay. Well, I will follow up for your city councilor, and we appreciate you sharing.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Brian Rowe.
Yeah.
Are there other members of the public who'd like to comment on something not on the agenda? Hi, how are you?
I'm Michelle Squire, and I live at 30 Lincoln Avenue in Northampton. And this is not the first time I've been here, but Brian wasn't here then. But we met with this, made an appearance at city council meeting this 2 weeks back. And our issue on Lincoln Avenue, as a lot of people know, our tractor trail trucks going through the industrial park, Coca-Cola, speeding 9 yards. And we've been working relentlessly over the years to try to find some kind of traffic calming, anything, trying to deter the trucks from coming the whole 9 yards. The article that was in the paper a couple weeks ago kind of referred back to what we haven't tried stuff before, but we have, and said we needed to come to this meeting here. So once again, signage on our street about the 25 kids that we have playing all the time. I have some plastic signs that I bought myself, but they don't hold up well in the winter. But I would like, you know, Williamsburg has some nice, pretty signs that says, "Say please drive safely. We love our children." Trying to get a speed limit lowered from 30 to 25. I mean, they've done put those strips in there and did the whole 9 yards. And yeah, people are going under 30, but we all feel that 30 is too fast for a street with 25 little kids. And also not that the tractor trailers are going 30. We thought maybe if we could get speed bumps even, maybe that would deter the tractor trailers. And maybe they would go down Damon Road like they're supposed to. Which is another issue, because I think most of the tractor trailers, not just going to Coca-Cola, along with other traffic, because we've had an increasing traffic from the PBTA buses also. I think the light at the end of Industrial Drive and Damon Road is great for getting out of the industrial park out that way. Coming in, there's no left turn signal. So when you're coming down Damon Road and those trucks those buses need to turn into the industrial park, nobody's nice enough to let them go. And I think that's one of the reasons that they're not going. They're coming through our neighborhood and headset. And one of our neighbors actually called and wrote to PBTA, so it's lightened up a lot, which was good. She wasn't happy. And we've talked and spoke. We've had meetings with Coca-Cola, which I think we need to do again, because, you know, the Mass DOT put the sign up on the highway coming off the ramp. I spoke with a gentleman, Bo, from there. And he's pretty much said the state's done what they can until they redirect that ramp, which they've been talking about for years. And he said that's supposed to be done by 2018, I think. They're going to put a roundabout there. Is that what they're going to do? So he said our best chance of trying to fix the whole truck issue was maybe bringing it up at those meetings when they come up again to try to, on that roundabout, try to feed them in the right direction instead of down toward town where they're coming. So, but they say that if they come down Bridge Street, you know, toward town, if they miss Lincoln or the other streets, and, you know, they put up all the signs with the $300 fines, which is fine, but I don't know who's gonna, spoke with the police department. Sergeant Barsh came by and with the neighborhood and talked, and, you know, they've been around, do what they can, but they're still trucks going down Day Avenue. It's like, but anyway, just to bring it all up once again, and we just don't know what else to do, but we have to do something, so we can't give up. But I think it's something between the city and Coca-Cola. I just think Coca-Cola's got to be able to do more. But anyway.
Well, thank you. And without getting into any real deliberation, I would just note that I think what this commission would be looking for Lincoln Avenue would be a traffic calming application, as we'll see from another street later in the
agenda. Yeah, we've done it a few years ago, but that's being...
Okay, well then we can talk, because there might be confusion. I don't think I'm in receipt of a traffic calming application. But if there's some bureaucratic mix-up there, and there is one, and it's missing, we can...
Yeah, I think we filed one a few years ago because we had a petition with everybody signing about everything, and that's when, you know, when Laura Hansen was around, she was helping us out a lot, but it's, once again, it's on.
Okay, well, that's something we'll
keep working on.
Talking about.
Okay.
Appreciate you coming and talking.
Okay, thank you, yep.
Is there any other public comment on other topics? You want to go with Mr. Squire? Want to go?
No.
Good afternoon, Ryan. Joe Squires, Joe's husband. Probably going to repeat a few things that she said, but this is what I spoke about at the city council meeting 2 weeks ago. Ryan was present. I believe the rest of you probably were not there. Been living on Lincoln Avenue for the past 27 years. The city of Northampton granted Coca-Cola in the industrial park an expansion several years back. The residents of Lincoln Avenue are paying the price. We have up to 20 to 25 tractor trailers a day going up and sometimes down the street. It is dirty and it is dangerous. The house shakes in the middle of the night as you try to sleep. We have lost our quality of life. Before the Coke plant came to Industrial Park, the city designated Lincoln Avenue as a truck detour to prevent trucks from getting stuck under the truck eating bridge. These trucks are using our street as a main route to the Coke plant. Within the past 5 years, up to 6 young families have moved on to Lincoln Avenue, all with very young kids. At least 20 kids, all under the age of 10, now call Lincoln Avenue their home. Hats off to these young parents as they have these kids outside playing 7 days a week in all kinds of weather, just like we all used to do when we were all young. There is an accident waiting to happen, hopefully not fatal, as they chase after a rolling ball. This past May and Mother's Day, a beautiful sunny day, we had a picnic in our yard for mothers, family, and friends. Up to 8 tractor trailers came through the street within a 3-hour period. Not a pretty sight. It felt like we were having a picnic on the breakdown lane of Interstate 91. The city of Northampton, along with Coca-Cola, who claim they want to be good neighbors, need to work on this together to put an end to the volume of trucks we face every day. I've had 2 former city councilors, Andrew Plasman, Owen Freeman Daniels, our present councilor, Ryan O'Donnell, along with former council president and now mayor, David Markowitz, at my house to try and come up with a solution to this problem, which has gone from bad to a nightmare. This is dating back 6 or 7 years. If we, the residents of Lincoln Avenue, the surrounding streets, call, text, or email our elected officials, please return our messages in a timely manner. We are depending on you to get this matter taken care of before action takes place. We need your help now more than ever. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Squires. Any other public comment? Yes.
Hi, my name is Cynthia Cochan. I have the misfortune of living on Bay Avenue, and I happen to be the house that is the first house on Bridge Street, so that anyone turning onto Bay Avenue would be turning from Bridge Street onto Bay. And they've discovered, the public has discovered, that it is a shorter route to come up the avenue to the light on Damon Road than it is to wait in the traffic that is happening on Damon Road.
Yes.
So we have another really serious problem. The people that live opposite me have about 13 vehicles. They're vans and trucks. They park right up and past the sign, do not park from here to corner. They park away from the curb so that it leaves very little room to actually make the turn through the 5 or 6 cars rushing up the avenue. So that's one problem, that a new problem that we have. And the other, of course, are the trucks. Now, there's been a sign on the avenue about a $300 fine for using that street. I have not seen any evidence of anyone policing the street. It's nice to get $10, $20, $300 fines, but I have not seen anyone policing the street to give out those fines. Also, the people across from me they take every opportunity to break the law. I mean, by parking in the driveways, they had a refrigerator sitting on their driveway for 10 days, door closed, which is against the law. Nobody except me reported it. I don't think anybody else did. And then one night they had a raging fire going against their garage. And we had the police department, which I called, and the fire department. So there's a lot of activity there. And the worst activity is that it is literally destroying my house. 9 years ago, my mother called me and said, "Cynthia, it's so cold in here, what's the matter?" Well, I went home and checked, and the vibration had moved the fuse box away from the electrical connection. It cost me $1,600 to have a circuit breaker put in. It also moved the front steps away from the front of the house. They cracked in half, and that was $525. So it was $2,025. Now, 7 months ago, the ceiling came down in the downstairs rental unit. A third of the ceiling dropped. So that is $950 that I don't get every month, because I have not been able to pay the $1,600 that the insurance company said it would cost. Now, I wrote a letter to City Hall and said, your insurance, will it pay for this? And a letter came back saying, no, the insurance would not pay for it. So I asked City Hall if they would pay for it. And the response that I got was, well, you say it's a vibration from the truck, so why don't you go find the truck that vibrated it and get the money from them? Very, very empathetic reply. So anyway, so it is just every repair I make has to be done by the computer. So I pay an extra $4,000 every 10 years on my taxes. And I don't want to do that anymore. So there must be some way to just attack this problem once and for all and stop it. If anyone has any suggestions, I'd be glad to hear.
Thank you, Ms. Kosher.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Ron. Good afternoon. I'm Henry Beefy, and I'm part of Washington. And when I was here at the meeting in May, there was a pretty good discussion about the number of sidewalks in Northampton and how do you get your arms around, how do you deal with all of this and prioritize them. As I said to you in an email between the May meeting and now, perhaps there is a way through public records that we can look at the accident and fatality records on sidewalks and crosswalks in the Northampton area, and so you can look at the danger of each of these depending upon how many accidents have been there. Or it could be, I suppose, speeding arrests and so on. And the reason I was at the meeting in May is that I'm a good friend of the student who was hit at Smith on the crosswalk in front of Allen Hills Hills Chapel. So I'm following up on that, and perhaps there's a way we can get our arms around the safety of sidewalks and how we prioritize making better. Thank you, Ryan.
Okay, thank you, Mr. And we will touch on that subject when we get to the fifth item on our agenda. Right. Is there any other public comment on an item not on the agenda? Well, thank you very much. So we'll launch into our main agenda. And the first item is item number 3. This commission has been reconstituted, as you all know, by the mayor's administrative order pursuant to the new charter. And as a result, a new provision we have to comply with is annual elections for officers for this commission per section 1.09 of the administrative order. So we have to do that by July of every year. And it is currently July. So unless there are any questions generally about that, we need to elect the chair and vice chair. And so I would entertain first a motion to open nominations for the election of chair of the commission. So, okay. So Mr. Lowenthal makes a motion to open nominations for the election of for just chair, and Councilor Klein seconds it. So the nominations are now open, and nominations from the floor are now in order. If anyone wants to nominate someone to serve as chair.
I nominate Councilor Ryan Donnell to be chair.
Thank you. No second. Any other nominations for position of chair? Okay. Then I would accept the motion, if there are no other nominations, to close nominations. So Mr. Pomerantz moves to close nominations. Is there a second? Mr. Lowenthal seconds. And all in favor of closing nominations?
Aye.
Okay, opposed? We have one nominee for chair. This is like Banana Republic here. I think a voice vote would be sufficient. I've been placed in nomination, so all in favor of me, your chair, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain. Thank you very much.
You.
You've already moved on. There'll be plenty of me talking throughout the meeting, more than you want. And so now I would entertain a motion to open nominations for the position of vice chair. Mr. Lowenthal makes the motion to open nominations for vice chair. Is there a second? Mr. Huntley seconds. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Nominations are open, and so nominations from the floor for the position of vice chair are now in order. I would nominate Councilor Lisa Klein. No second is necessary, but someone who seconded just to show support.
Second.
Okay, you received 2 seconds from Mr. Lowenthal and Mr. Huntley. Are there any other nominations for the position of vice chair? Going once, going twice. In that case, I accept the motion to close nominations for vice chair. Mr. Pomerantz makes a motion to close nominations. Is there a second? Mr. Grinnett, Ms. Grinnett, am I saying your name right?
Yeah.
Correct. Okay, thank you. Ms. Grinnett is a new member of the commission. Seconds it, and so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Nominations are closed. So we have one nominee, Councilor Klein. All in favor of that nominee? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Congratulations. No change has happened. Excellent. Okay, so now we're on to item 4, which is approval of minutes from June 16th and May 19th. And unless there is objection, I would like to postpone the approval of these minutes to the next meeting because there's simply, for bureaucratic reasons, these minutes are not prepared yet to be voted on, so that's okay. So without objection, we'll do that next month. Item number 5. Updates, well, I'll tell you what, actually, if it's okay with the commission, I'd like to take some things out of order. Some of these could involve lots of conversation, and I know that Patty Shaughnessy, Director of the Council on Aging, is here to talk about item number 11, which is an ordinance for the purpose of codifying existing 4 handicapped parking spaces at the Senior Center and also adding more spaces. So that's an ordinance that you have in your packet, but I'd like to invite Ms. Shaughnessy to come up and speak to the need for this.
So back in October, I came before the commission to talk about additional handicap parking at the Senior Center. And currently we have 4 spaces, and it's very inadequate for the number of individuals that we provide services to. There are letters of support that have come from the Friends Group of the Northampton Senior Services, from the Council on Aging Board, from a particular senior. You don't have all of these letters, you only have two of the letters and another letter from myself. And the Disability Commission has also taken a vote probably two times to support additional handicap parking at the senior center. I think we all know that there's handicap parking required by federal law, and the four spaces we have, as I said, is not adequate. What we do know is that handicap spaces are there for people if there is a need for them with their placard or license plate that's been issued by the Registry of Motor Vehicles to be in need of a handicap spot. And from observation, from interactions with people coming into the senior center, and I'm just going to add that not everybody who comes into the senior center is a senior. We have many additional programs at the senior center there for the general public, for the community. For example, Election Day, there are well over a couple thousand extra people in that building, and four handicap spots are not adequate. There have been numerous occasions where staff will go out to move cars so that a disabled person has the ability to get off at the curb, come into the building, and we move their car further out into the behind Walter Salvo or to the back parking lot. So there really is a need for additional handicap parking.
Thank you very much, Ms. Shaughnessy. Are there questions for Ms. Shaughnessy? Ms. Palmer?
No questions for Patty. Just a note to the commission members. I did spend some time with Patty down at the senior center and looked at the existing parking layout with the four parking spaces. And the proposed ordinance change to add the additional three spaces would give Patty seven spaces on sort of what's called the inner core parking area of the senior center, so close to the building. And I think it's certainly a good move. And I would certainly support adding three spaces.
Okay.
I'd like to ask a quick question. Does the seven feel like an adequate number to you? Is that going to take care of the problem?
I think it's a good start, and as I was talking to Mr. Pomerantz, we'll see how that works and then move forward if it looks like we need more parking for persons with disabilities.
Any other questions of Ms. Shaughnessy? Well, I would accept, just to get on the floor, is there a motion to approve this ordinance to codify the handicapped parking spaces? Motion for a positive recommendation of the ordinance. Okay, Councilor Klein makes the motion for a positive approval of the ordinance. Is there a second? Mr. Hartwell seconds it. Okay, discussion on the ordinance. As a person who sort of put it together, Mr. Palmer has pretty much explained what it is. Through the very sophisticated software called Photoshop, I have indicated where the parking spaces would go because handicapped parking spaces are wider because of the need for a wider aisle between the spaces. Four parking spaces become three handicapped spaces, and you can see where they would go in the center aisle here. And the ordinance simply puts it into the table in section 312.117, schedule 16 of the Code of Ordinances of the City, on-street and off-street handicapped parking spaces. It adds two lines, both for Northampton Senior Center lot. The first location is four spaces at the northwesterly corner of the lot. That is the current four spaces we have. That was simply not in the Code of Ordinances before. And the second row we would add is Northampton Senior Center. On the western side of the center aisle of the lot, three spaces, starting at the space closest to the Senior Center. So this ordinance, if approved, would provide three extra spaces. Any comment on the ordinance? Mr. Hyman?
Just a quick question. Are there any other center islands in the lots out there that this could be confused with? I know there's parking on the westerly side, additional parking, but I'm not sure if there's center islands there or not. Just want to make sure it's clear.
Yeah, no, I'm only going on what I see the map, I mean, the Fruit Street, I guess, kind of, I don't know if you would continue to call that Fruit Street, where it kind of bisects the parking lot, there's kind of two sections.
McDonald Way.
I mean, to me, there's just one center aisle, and then you get to the end of the parking lot, and then you're into Walter Saga House.
So down here, there's more additional parking for the senior center?
Correct.
I'm not sure if there's any center islands down there that the language would be confused with. I just want to make sure it's clear, that's all.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So the parking that's closest to the building is called senior center parking. In the back of the building, where there is a center aisle, that's called Cahill parking. It's a shared parking lot that we both do different aspects of taking care of that with the housing authority.
So my opinion is it would be clear because we're specifying a senior center lot, number one, and secondly, there is only one center aisle, and it's, we specify on the western side of it. We could say northwestern if that was clearer. Mr. Huntley, Mr. Pond, I see the opinion on whether to say northwestern or how we define language as it is.
I'd say northwestern.
Well, can we amend it without objection? Say northwestern. So, without objection, what we're going to do is add, just turn western into northwestern. Okay. Any other comment on the ordinance as its current state? The motion on the floor for a positive recommendation. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for your persistence.
Thank you for letting me come out of order. Not that everybody doesn't have something important to go to, but we have a disability commission meeting next. But could I just ask one question? So what is the next step for this ordinance?
This will go to City Council at our next meeting, refer to the Ordinance Committee meeting. And then the Ordinance Committee will review it and make its recommendation. It'll go back to the council, and it needs two votes to go to the mayor for signature.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Now, I think it would be actually appropriate if we can go to the traffic calming applications. And item 8 and 9, because we have lots of visitors for those items. Here's just briefly, here's the thing. I'm in receipt of two applications, both of which seem to be for the intersection of Hatfield and Cook Avenue. One comes from Ms. Catherine Langdon of 51 Pilgrim Drive, and another comes from Kim Gerald of 66 Pines Edge Drive. I don't know if they're identical. We may merge them at some point, but why don't we start? Is Ms. Catherine Langdon here?
Yes.
Ms. Langdon, would you present the basic issue for us?
I do carpooling for children, and I have to cross Hatfield several mornings a week. And I was crossing from Cook across Hatfield, and I had just started up. I had looked both directions, and a car came out from the left very, very fast. I pulled quickly to the right. They sort of skimmed my car. It was one of those things that I was very, very lucky that I wasn't in a very serious accident. There were cars coming from the other direction. There were not cars coming from the other direction, which was also a very lucky thing. They didn't stop when they saw our cars over to the left. But it frightened me, of course. And so I began to think about that spot more carefully. And I realized that there's a curb there, but there is also hedges and planting and so forth. I understand that some of that may have been cleared up a little bit. I don't know. I'm not driving during the summer. But I just wanted to make sure that that it was brought to the table that is a very dangerous spot. Yeah.
Thank you. Are there questions for Ms. Lundy? Any questions for the commission?
Just a point of information. This was brought to our attention about 2 weeks ago. And so we've asked the task force to look into it because that's regulated under zoning, sight line distances from intersecting side streets. And that's the issue down there is this beautiful plantings that the apartment complex has and hinders the view. So we started working with Louie on that as a separate issue.
No, it's related.
And I saw these two traffic calming applications come in that both discuss about this landscaping that's hindering the sightline distances. Just a comment.
Okay. Right. I mean, my question, is speed part of this issue?
Yes, speed is definitely part of it. Okay. I talked to the woman and she said, oh, I have to brake, which meant to me that she was going too fast, that she had to brake just not hit me. I've driven that road since then and realized that the 30 mile an hour speed limit is not being honored.
Okay.
So.
I'm sorry for being thick. Just to be clear, I mean the street with the speeding is
Hatfield.
Okay.
Yeah. It's difficult just to get across Hatfield. And if you have children going that way on bicycles, I don't want to be a parent with that child. Thank you
very much. So it sounds like, if I'm seeing nodding of heads, it seems like both applications are essentially identical
yes.
on purpose.
Yes, but we have more to
say. No, not on purpose.
We
just matter.
In purpose.
In purpose.
In purpose.
Really accidental.
Don't use the word accident.
But
since we do have two applications, I would like to invite Gerald to also speak on hers.
Right.
The one she's signing.
Thank you. I'm Kim Gerald. I live at 66 Pines Edge Drive. And Kit's introduction to this is perfect because that's what we want to avoid, somebody getting killed or hurt. So do you have my application with my lovely, very professional map? Because that really helps you imagine it. So you were coming down Cook Avenue and taking a turn there. That's the scary spot. And as you can see, the problem is speeding, but the problem is also the configuration of Hatfield Street. It's just coming down and boom, all of a sudden, there's an intersection there that nobody expects. Now, the good news is that, you know, there's more line, which was painted in, you know, a little while ago. It says there's an intersection coming. It's hard to know it's 30 miles per hour because there's one sign at the beginning of routes 5 and 10, there's one at the beginning of Bridge Road that they're sort of run over, and even some of my neighbors didn't know that it was 30, I thought it was 35, but it is 30 miles per hour. But very few people are traveling at that speed because they're coming off routes 5 and 10 where you're going 40, 45, and it's a beautifully paved road and you can just zoom over to Bridge Road. And the same coming from the other direction, you come up the hill, and we don't see those cars until they're up over the hill. So it's double whammy. We have to look this way, and we have to look this way. And so when I noticed that the hedges were all grown over, that's when I contacted the DPW.
Okay.
And you guys were so responsive, we're so grateful because you trimmed them back. So it's a start. I think a few more hedges have to go. I've heard that the Laurel Ridge is very amenable and cooperative, so it's better. And sometimes in the winter, it's a problem. So you really have no idea who's coming. My big technique is I roll down my window, I get out as far as I can, I do everything, and then I take a deep breath and I gun it. You know,
all the way and look left last.
Look left last. And we are probably the best protected because we have to do this many times a day. It's the visitors. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, I went across it yesterday with a friend and she was shocked to see a car coming, and instead of gunning it, she slowed down and I was screaming. I was just like, go. So, you know, there have been many accidents, and sadly, many years ago, my husband witnessed a fatality there. A woman was killed coming out from the other direction and a truck hit her and killed her. So we don't want this to happen. And as I canvassed our neighborhood, I got even more worried because everybody was like, oh yeah, I had a near miss there. Oh yeah, I almost got hit. Oh yeah, it's not good. So we've got speeding. Visibility issues, I think, can be dealt with. If we deal with the landscaping, there's grass in front of the house at 340 Hatfield, which isn't cut, that makes it hard to see. Those things I think we can deal with, but I think what we need traffic calming for is Hatfield Street, because Nobody knows what the speed limit is. They don't know an intersection's coming. They don't know that it's a dangerous intersection. From one direction, from Bridge Road, it does say caution intersection, which actually isn't the most dangerous way you're coming. This is the most dangerous. And so there should be like flashing lights, caution intersection. God forbid you want to walk across the street or cross with your bike. I bike a lot, and that's really scary. There's no crosswalk, and you just really have to listen and look and go fast. When I drive 30 miles per hour down Hatfield Street, which I've been trying to be very mindful about lately, everybody's behind you, like, come on! You can see, you know, you've got a big line. People are not used to driving at 30 miles per hour because it's such a comfortable road to speed on. And other people have mentioned to me they've seen people passing on Hatfield Street. I assume it's a no-passing zone. It would be great to have double yellow lines to remind people, because passing, I've heard some very frightening stories about when people have tried to pull out and somebody's actually been passing. So I think those are the main issues. I mean, some of it we can't, you know, it's the angle of the street. It's just extremely dangerous. And then there's one more thing, is the added traffic because of the closing of exit 20. Probably more people are using the road. But this has been an issue for long term. I've lived there 22 years. This issue has been all the time. And people, I know there's been long ago, there were conversations, and I'm sure people in the audience are aware of previous conversations that have taken place. So that's just a brief.
Okay.
And oh, the last thing I want to say is please come up. Try it. I mean, I don't mean to put you in danger or anything, but please just drive up. The Moose Lodge is great. You can take a walk down to Fitzgerald Lake. A lot of people come up there to walk their dogs. They're, I'm sure, aware of it too. But come up, turn around, and try it. But be very careful. Hold on your window. Really look back, make sure that you can see every way, and then don't slow down. Go as fast as you can. Oh, and thanks to the DPW. Also, yesterday they swept the streets. So there was a lot of gravel there. So we were skidding as we tried to get out of there, and that's gone. So yay, DPW. We got hedges trimmed, we got the road swept. So we're really grateful to how quickly you responded to this.
Yes, thank you.
Well, thank
so you very
questions?
Much. And sounds like you're kind of sucking up to the DPW.
Yes. I know, I really chatted up a guy there the other day when he was in his truck. Yeah.
I know there are other people who wish to speak. I would just like to, at this point, offer some explanation about traffic calming applications in general. Kind of neglected to do that, because I am hearing multiple issues, and as Director Huntley pointed out, there are some, like landscaping and clipping back vegetation and visibility, that aren't strictly speaking part of the traffic calming process. It doesn't mean they're not relevant or that this commission can't devote time to it, because it sounds like there are multiple issues that are part of a larger problem. But strictly speaking, the traffic calming application and the traffic calming process, which you have begun, is one that would begin today with a vote by the commission on whether or not to do a traffic study, to have the DPW go out and essentially measure speed, presumably on Hatfield Street. The traffic calming process, surprisingly to many people, is not about changing the speed limit. That is actually a separate state process. Doesn't mean it can't be looked at, but it's not, strictly speaking, part of the traffic calming application process the city does. If a vote succeeds to do the study would be done by the DPW, and they would bring back information on the actual speeding stats that are recorded. And, you know, frankly, I'm not saying this is the case with Hatfield Street, but sometimes we do the measurements and there is no speeding. And we simply have to have a fair process by which to proceed with certain streets and not proceed with others. So That's what would happen today as a first step. And then it would come back. There's a queue of projects. There are about, what, 20, 25 currently in the queue. And they receive a ranking, a numerical ranking. And I think you'll know this if you read the application, which I imagine you have. The ranking depends on community support. It depends on money and other factors. Mm-hmm. And then, again, we move forward with the traffic common projects where we can and as much as we can. But I wanted to make that clear. There are some things the traffic calming application process does and some things it doesn't, just to be clear. Did I leave anything out with that explanation? Okay. Well, so we would like to...
Can I ask a clarifying question?
Please, yes.
Is speed the only factor, or are things like hills and curves that impact sight lines also considered as part of traffic calming?
Someone else?
Road geometry can be part of the consideration of it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a traffic expert, but I have to say that I think the geometry of the fact that there's a hill on one side and a sharp curve on the other is definitely a factor, because speed makes cars, you know, take fewer seconds, but the fact that you can't see a long distance. Yeah. So it's to me, there's, you know, just in terms of the geometry,
right.
When I turn this way for a few seconds and then I turn back for a few seconds, it's not just the speed, but the fact that there isn't a long vista.
Gotcha.
So I would hope in terms of the rankings that's sort of just part of this particular difficult intersection.
Well, thank you for that comment. It sounds like road geometry is part of the process.
Yes.
So. Would anyone want to comment, please come up, and if you would, just state your name and address for the record.
Pat Main at 18 Pines Edge. Pat Main at 18 Pines Edge. And I'm just going to sort of be repeating, but just to add another layer to this, I did have a friend come up several years ago from Rhode Island, came to that intersection, stopped, thought it was a four-way just because of the way it was set up, and proceeded through, and she was hit. So I had written to the commission several years ago requesting maybe a four-way stop or, you know, some kind of a speed bump. They have done studies there. Somehow the response came back, not enough speed, not enough accidents, whatever. But as you can hear, see what everyone's saying, it's a real concern. And another real concern that someone mentioned is there's a beautiful sidewalk there, but you have to cross the street to get to it. And we really, really need a crosswalk there. That, I think, would be number one. I noticed there's a young man, I believe, I don't know if he's from Emily Heights or somewhere, but I've seen him come down in a wheelchair trying to get across that street.
Yes.
I mean, have to have a crosswalk. That's like number one. And that would kind of automatically slow people down. So I guess that's it.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Any other comments anyone would like to speak?
Hi, I'm Kimberly Lambert, 97 Pines Edge Drive. And my little note here is to the Traffic Safety Committee, the Mayor, Safety Officer for Northampton Police Department, DPW Board of Directors. Thank you so, so much for trimming the shrubs at the corner of our street, Mr. DPW. And that's made a huge difference already. But now we have grass growing up on the right side. Walmart, the owners of that property, had very high grass at the end of Cook Ave growing there for some time. A couple of weeks ago it was cut. You couldn't see when you were trying to go up Cook Ave from the right side around the curb because the grass was so high. And I believe that's a property company located somewhere in Ohio. Death, hospitalizations, near misses, trauma, and terror characterize the events and experiences that residents, family, and friends have had at the intersection of Cook Ave and Hatfield Street over the 25 years that I have lived in this neighborhood. In the early 90s, the tragic death of a good woman sparked a neighborhood meeting with city officials at the JFK Middle School. Over 75 people attended that night. An active group formed, and for about 2 years, painted and posted signs up and down Hatfield Street. You might have seen the Creatures Crossing signs years ago, and met monthly with City Councilor Dwight. On occasion, an occasional speed sign was placed, the electronic ones, and an occasional officer was at the intersection somewhere in that area once in a while. Yet, at some point, the road was repaved. I don't know if it was gas or what, repaved, it seemed to be widened. The entrance of Hatfield and North King was widened. The corners disappeared, so there was no corner to slow people down coming. They come off 91 down North King. They're doing 50 miles an hour when they come onto Hatfield. So the speed increased. Later, a hurricane took down a limb or two and off the old growth trees that were a major force in calming the traffic on Hatfield Street. Those trees were removed by National Grid. They were a major force on calming the traffic on Hatfield Street. There were several of them and they were never replaced. Please protect the existing trees by designating them in some way to protect them properly. Maybe get the tree committee involved or something. So we're here again to plead that the city take the steps within your power to calm, regulate, and slow traffic at this extremely dangerous intersection. I myself have seen a winter accident there where a woman sat slumped in her car. The guy was driving a pickup truck, and I didn't even know she was in her car until the ambulance came. And it was a cold winter night. It was a terrible, terrible situation, but someone was speeding around the corner in a pickup truck. And there she was. She went to the hospital. I don't know what happened. Here are my suggestions. Replant the trees on Hatfield Street. Close up the entrance on North King Street. Or put corners back in and narrow the entrance. Paint no passing lines the length of Hatfield Street. And add a crosswalk, please. I mean, we're like captives up there in the hill. We can't even go shopping in our own neighborhood. And the children, you know, we have a few children. They like to ride their bikes. We have little toddlers. People with carriages, they can't cross that street. They want to use the businesses down at the bottom of the hill. Trim, add the crosswalk, and please trim several times. You know the DPW is great when you call them or you go down, sign, fill out a work order, which I myself have done several times every spring. Takes a couple of months, they get to it. The speed limit signs are always covered in brush. They need to go out, you know, a couple times in the spring, a couple times at the end of the summer. Clear those out. Don't cut the trees, please. And, you know, keep up the trimming around the speed signs, the shrub and growth at the sight lines of the intersections. And please provide accident data to this people in this group or someone in this group so that we can start to collect some information about, you know, we know one person, unfortunately, regretfully, was killed there. I know people have been sent to the hospital there many times. But I can't get the data. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Ms. Lambert, may I ask you one question?
Yeah.
When you talk about the importance of trees, how did the trees calm traffic?
They are so big, and they were growing at the edge of Hatfield Street. You'll see, you take a ride down there, you'll see there's a couple out there now. So let's pray that they stay there. It's a visual. I've gone to traffic calming meetings when they had someone from Sweden come like 10 years ago and give talks about traffic calming. And they actually had a traffic calming expert on the employee of the city's docket. And trees are really important. If people get an impression as they're going along, they're speeding, that the road is narrowing, the trees give you a vertical impression that, you know, we need to be careful, we need to slow down. So.
Thank you. Other comments from the public? Please.
Hi, my name is Andrea James, and I live at 91 Pines Edge. Thank you very much for listening to our comments. I've only lived in Pines Edge for 1 year, just shy of 2 days, actually. And I was probably one of those people, honestly, going a little faster than 30 miles per hour a year ago. because it's one of those streets where you say, what is the speed limit here? As you're driving, because there's one sign kind of right when you make that quick turn, and then there's never another one. And I really do feel that people like me who are generally very good citizens who don't want to drive too fast are taken by surprise if they do see a person in the road crossing, because it just comes too quickly. I'm also a cycler and a walker and a runner, and I'm agile enough to race across the street, but that kind of eliminates people. It doesn't seem fair that people aren't able to to have some kind of a crosswalk there to allow them to walk and ride and push carriages and the like. I wouldn't want to be a parent pushing a carriage across there. I would want to risk my child's life there. So anyway, thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. And Captain Carlos, there's no need to arrest this woman for speeding. Other members of the group?
I'm Jessica Morrison, the 87 Pine Village. And I don't want to repeat things that have been said before. I just wanted to add that my daughter is a school-aged child, and in conversation with the public school's busing system, I have been told that the police department has determined that to be a dangerous intersection, making her eligible for transportation because she is not considered, school children are not considered to be safe to walk from our neighborhood of Pines Edge, Cook, and Emily Lane to Jackson Street School, which is our school district. So I thought that might be interesting information for you. So I think a quick call to the public school transportation coordinator, Joy, would give you some more information about how that is determined. I don't know if she just told me that. So my daughter has door-to-door transportation to Jackson Street because it's way too dangerous at an intersection to walk. And you know, it really limits her as she wants to be able to walk and bike around. There's no way that she can be able to go anywhere near that intersection. And I just wanted to add my voice in the decade that I've lived there. I have been in so many close calls. I have seen so many accidents that the Laurel Ridge Apartments have gone through probably 20 different signs because there are times when they're routinely knocked down. And all of the kinds of things that the DPW I know needs to take care of every street in Northampton, and I know that they can't come very often, but things like the ice patches that form at the bottom of Cook as you're waiting prevent you from gunning, and as we said, the only way to get across is when you see an opening you have to gun because you only have a few seconds. And so, you know, it's hard. I have a front wheel drive car and I tried to figure out like how far can I get in front of the ice so that I can gun it and get the power and or the gravel, you know, just you could hear the gravel going as you try to gun across. I had to call the DPW a couple of times for ice remediation. It was a bad winter for all of us, I know, but the ice was really terrible. So, you know, it's sort of every season. We've talked a lot about how the growth in the summertime, in the wintertime, it's the snow mounds and the patches of ice underneath the snow. So there have been times when I have gone to gun it and stuck on the ice,
yeah,
and then a car comes screaming by me, you know, honking its horn, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, when there's really nothing I can do. I'm just trying to get traction so I can get across. But it's a really big issue. When I first moved to the area, I was on the phone a lot with Bill Dwight, who was at that point our city council person, saying, you know, please can something be done? And he said, we're hoping to turn the King Street, Hatfield Street intersection into a hard right rather than a soft right, because a hard right forces the traffic to calm down. We're hoping to get Big Y to pay for it when they do the renovations, but that didn't happen. Instead, as Kim says, it's just gotten even easier for people to keep it at that 50 mile an hour as they make that soft right turn. So I'm really hoping, as I had said in my question, I really feel like it's a combination of speed and geometry, because literally you can't turn your head and have your eyes process the information. So I would like to just second the invitation to please, as you're driving around, if you happen to be in our neighborhood, to please just try coming, turn around at the Moose Lodge, or come into Pines Edge and use our nice circle, turn around, go back out, and get a firsthand experience of what it's like.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Ms. Morris,
yeah.
Can I ask, is there a drainage problem?
So, yeah. You know, there are many places where there are drainage problems, and this winter was bad everywhere, so.
Okay, but in the summer you get pools of water there?
In the summer, we do sometimes get pools of water, but it's more in the winter,
yeah,
when it, you know, it melts the top layer and then freezes at night.
That's
and
the
then melts the top layer. So I don't know what other people feel about pools. Sometimes
the bottom of the hill, so it's sand.
Okay,
the sand
is
bad.
Yeah,
we'll check it out.
We'll take comments one by one. Is there anyone else who wants to?
Yeah, I'd like to.
Yes, sir.
My name's Peter Corbett, 89 Pines Edge Drive.
and I'd like to offer my services, and I'll cut everything down. Because what they did is they trimmed it, and they did a good job, don't get me wrong. And you can see better, but it's all going to grow up. That tree's going to start dangling down, and I'm going to have to go, whoop, get out there, okay. That's what happens. Okay. Many, many times I'm like, whoa. And some of those trucks go flying like that. Everyone will admit to it. And I hope I don't have to wait 6 years like that other guy. Because you may see my face in the newspaper for destruction of personal property. Because I'm going to cut it down before somebody dies.
Thank you, Mr. Clark.
Thank you.
Any other comments, sir?
Can I go?
Yes, please.
I'll add my name to the list, too. My name is Robert Boynton. I'm Emily Lane. So, as you know, that's our only egress. Emily Lane, Pines Edge, Cook Avenue. That's the only way we can get in and out of our property. I've been there 27 years, so I meet you, Kim.
Yes.
But the reason why I was there was a nice, quiet, dead-end street there, and it was great raising family. I still have a son who has special needs that needs to cross that street, and we won't let him do that because he will not make it. Give you back some history, Walmart was coming in. I don't know if you guys remember before Walmart was here. We did a big study, the police department was active, the DPW. We did a study with the state to see if we could get a four-way stop sign in there, even a traffic light. We didn't have enough cars. And it's not during the whole day, it's only morning rush hour, evening rush hour, between 7 and 9, 10, and 4 and 7. That's where the really rush is. Everything else doesn't add up enough to have enough cars to do any work there. So we did all this work about 20 years ago, and nothing came of it. All we did was that. And the things have gotten slowly worse because you have Riverview Market now at the end of Route 5 that has added it. People going to Walmart, that has added quite a bit. The trucks are coming out of Walmart because that's where they're doing their delivery. They don't have to come up by Hatfield Street. So we're just getting more and more traffic. And people are trying to avoid Bridge Road. As you know, Bridge Road gets backed up quite a bit going down to the Route 5 intersection. So we're using Bridge Road as a shortcut. And unfortunately, a couple years ago, our road was fixed thanks to DPW. It was really horrible. But now it's too wide. The trees have come down, as they have said. And it's just a speedway coming down Route 5 as you're heading south, taking a shortcut to go out to Florence or Leeds. And it's a very, very fast road. So what we do is look left, look right, look left, and gun it and pray that you don't get hit. That's basically how it is. So I appreciate all your concerns and your listening and your time. Thank you. I
appreciate your comments. Thank you. Other members of the public like this want to comment on this? Oh, please.
Hi, I'm Marie Trombley, and I'm Emily Lane also, and I have three girls, and I would love to bring them to the grocery store, and we are in always this debate, do we walk to the grocery store, which would be a nicer way than to take a car, maybe, 100 feet down the road, but then you have to think about crossing that street with them. And same thing with the bike path. We're kind of in our little neighborhood, it's beautiful, it's a dead-end street, but to go out of there to reach a bike path, there's just that intersection. That's really the only thing that prevents us. Because once you cross, then there's a nice sidewalk. We're great. So I heard other neighbors saying the same thing. It's like we have this beautiful way to go to town, but we can't because there's that intersection that's kind of dangerous.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
I have one thing. My name is Eric Reisinger. I'm at 95 Pines Edge Drive.
Yeah, feel free to
let me get out of here. So, Andrea kind of touched on this. I just wanted to point out that the other side is that just like we can't see people coming from these directions, they can't see us trying to get out of the drive. So it's kind of not fair to everybody coming along Hatfield as well. We don't like feeling trapped in there, but people coming around the curve too quickly, they don't want to find us, halfway at the intersection more than we want to be found by them. So it's sort of like an issue for the entire neighborhood and anybody who drives.
That's important.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good point.
Anyone else? Feel free. Okay. If not, I'd like to turn to the commission for some deliberation on this. Obviously, what we would have to do today is decide whether to request that the DPW proceed with traffic study as a first step. But we can start discussion. Did you have your hand up first, Counselor?
I just wanted to ask about what's happening with the King Street roundabout, because I imagine that that's going to change things. It's going to slow traffic down for quite a while. There's some construction. I think sidewalks are supposed to be put in as part of that project. So I just want to have Mr. Heath and Director Holmes can tell us kind of how this fits into this picture.
Sure, I was going to offer several comments on what was just taken up by the public hearing also. The roadway got repaved because of Berkshire Gas going through a large pipeline project probably 10 years, 12 years ago or so. They donated money to the city, which was used to repave the road. The road was not widened as part of that project. It was the existing pavement. So that's kind of the fact there. The other thing that came up 2 years ago is MassDOT came through across the Commonwealth with a program for the six highest crash intersections in the community. And this is one of the intersections that received advanced warning signs of the streets coming, and actually painted WO sound lines on the street itself on that section, if I call right, of Hatfield Street. So that was a project that was done 2 years ago by MassDOT, and I said there's five other communities that were, or intersections that were addressed in the city. And lastly, on the North King Street, Hatfield Street roundabout, we're in the process of making 25% submittal plans to MassDOT on that. I reviewed the plans last week. I put some minor comments with Wayne Friedman. I believe it's in the 2018 TIP program for construction. So it's still a few years away, but that will include a big slowdown in traffic at that intersection and the roundabout. This will also be a sidewalk the entire length of Hatfield Street up to Cook Avenue on the easterly side, which is the Valley Motorsports Walmart side.
Just to be clear, the roundabout planned by the state is at North King and Hatfield.
That's correct.
Expect that in 2018. Any other comments on the situation?
I'm very familiar with the intersection. I live only a mile and a half from there. I bike through there all the time. And so I know exactly what you're talking about. I completely agree that it's dangerous and speeds are high. I think the visibility issue is a double-edged sword. You might find that if you made it completely visible, you cut down all the trees in sight and everybody could see everybody, that it would increase the speed and you would have no net gain in safety. I feel as if this is exactly the right thing to do to request a traffic calming study, and I'm going to move the DPW assemble the crash and speed and traffic volume statistics, and that the TPC, the Transportation Parking Committee, should move forward with the study. I think it should go on the list. I think it should be ranked. My prediction is it will rank fairly highly. Nobody can guarantee exactly where. As the chair mentioned, there's a ranking system that depends on points that includes speeding, but also the volume of traffic, also the presence of nearby residences, businesses, schools, the presence or absence of sidewalks, all of those things assemble points that go into the final ranking. Mm-hmm. My guess is that that this would rank fairly highly for all the reasons that you said, and I agree with you. I think in particular, the important point is the speeds have to come down, and that's not going to happen by the speed limit. That's going to happen by the design of the roadway. The design of the roadway tells you, as a driver, what seems like an appropriate speed. Yeah. The speed limit, as Councilor O'Donnell mentioned, is a state set limit, and basically they just look at the speed people are going, and they use the 85th percentile system, which looks at 100% of the cars, and then they look at the speed of the 85% slowest car. So they ignore the 15% fastest cars, but they say whatever speed 85% of the traffic is going, or slower than that, that's the speed that we should set the limit at. Hmm. So if you did that now, you might find that the state would come and say, oh, well, we should actually up it from 30 to 40,
right,
or whatever. So what this says to me, and this is exactly what the traffic calming program is meant to fix, to solve, is that the design of the roadway allows and encourages speed that is too fast for your quality of life, for everybody's safety, mm-hmm. and that's what we should fix. Right. And so I think, I really believe it has to do with the physical layout of the road.
Yeah.
We don't know yet exactly what the solution is, but there's a whole toolkit, and the city has, shall I say, come up to speed mm-hmm. on this over the last quite a few years. And as you travel around the city, you'll see various solutions to speeding mm-hmm. that have been mm-hmm. tried, some of them more successful than others. But there's a whole toolkit to slowing the traffic down to what every, you know, what all of you, the residents, would agree is a whole reason to speed. And I think that should happen. So I move that the TPC recommend for further study this traffic calming.
Requests that the DPW take the first step of this process and do this analysis and study. Councilor Klein seconds the motion. And I would like to ask, just as a friendly amendment, that we merge both these applications into one request.
I accept the friendly amendment.
Any discussion on the motion to make this recommendation? Ms. Pop.
I would certainly support passing the recommendation so we can initiate the study. And I'd like to ask Captain Cartlidge, why did we do, in fact, okay, include doing the traffic study? Is there anything that we could do during that study phase on through PD? Could we have some increased enforcement? The speed sign, we've talked before that the speed sign is put in place, but to do something while the study is being done for more enforcement to slow traffic down.
Definitely, we would increase our visibility there, run more traffic details, and get the speed sign out there as much as possible. And anything else that the public suggested, we could try to work with any residents in the area to work on that.
Great, thank you. Any other discussion on the motion to make this recommendation? Okay. Then all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Thank you all very much for being in touch. Thank you. Thank you. Subcommittee updates. Is there anyone from bicycle pedestrian subcommittee that wants to update us on, in particular, the crosswalk inventory?
I don't think we had a meeting since the last time we've seen any.
I see.
Okay. We have a meeting. Last week's meeting was rescheduled for next week.
Okay. And if you're in public comment, there's an interest in integrating accident information into that study. My understanding is the planning department is taking the lead on creating criteria to narrow down the number of crosswalks we'd be looking at in the city. And that's an ongoing process, but I agree with the member of the public who suggested that we integrate accident information into that. So maybe the police department could be in touch with the planning department and see if that information could be provided.
Sure.
Coordination could happen. That would be great. Thank you. And unfortunately, until we have other information, I'm not sure there's much else to discuss right now, unless any members of the commission want to discuss anything else about this. Great. Well, updates from the DPW or the departments?
Sure, we have a couple of things that have happened in the past since the last meeting. We opened the traffic signal bid, we call it Traffic Signal 2015, which included audible signals on two intersections at the intersection of South Street, New South Street, Old South Street, and Constant Old South Street. That came through request through Patty Shaughnessy. And we also, in that project, is also the Bridge Road School flashing lights and the RRFB for the pedestrian crossing there also. That was part of that, and also just some standard work to be done in the city for loop replacement at Barrett and at West Street. Make sure the signals are working a little better, that's all. So that's been opened, and we had one bidder on that, Dago Electric, and we're in the process of signing contracts now to get the work installed, and Bridge Road will be a priority. Hot Mix Asphalt starts this first week of August through contact with Warner Brothers. So now we have a number of streets. If you want to see what they are, go to our website. They're listed there under the projects. And on Tuesday, July 28th, we have a new transportation engineer starting with us. Her name is Maggie Chan. And she's a recent graduate of a civil engineering degree, 4-year degree at college. So she'll be joining us, like I said, on that Tuesday. Very excited about having her come on board.
Absolutely. Questions for Director Hendrick? Thank you very much.
Yep.
Item number 7 is proposed amendment to our rules for this commission. It's pretty straightforward. Originally, we had put in here that we would create a policy to process parking change requests from residents in neighborhoods. In other words, we get a lot of these. People say, well, I want no parking here, or I want to, you know, change the parking rules in residential parts of the streets and of the city. And when we wrote the rules, we simply hadn't finished that yet, and so we wrote in that we would do it by a certain date. The reality is that the date has passed, and I think at this point, what this amendment proposes to do would be to take that out of the rules. It's still something that we can discuss at a future time, but we might as well amend the rules to conform with reality, since we have not done that, and we're not going to be putting that into the rules anytime soon. So, if that's clear, are there any questions on that amendment? It's almost a technical amendment. Well, I would move that we amend the rules as described in here, which is pretty much eliminating section 3.3 and the addendum that is now reserved in blank. So that's my motion. Is there a second to accept that amendment?
I'll second that.
Okay, Mr. Harwell seconds. Is there a discussion on accepting that amendment to the rules? No? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Let's see. Now we are back to our ordinances. Item number 10 is.
Excuse me, Ryan.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Carrie. Dave Conrad's going to vote on that last. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item number 10 is. Eluding me. Here it is. Item number 10 is. An amendment to section 312.104, schedule 3, limited time parking. It has to do with the 15 minute space on North Maple Street in Florence. Best way to understand it is there's a picture that goes along with it. This is the sign that currently exists. The sign reads 15 minute parking, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Exclusion of Sundays and holidays, and on Friday extended to 9 p.m. So in the table, we simply make the table conform with what the sign says. Currently it just says North Maple Street easterly, 15 minutes all, no parking other than parallel. And we would amend that to read 15 minutes, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., all except Sundays and public holidays, and extend it to 9 p.m. on Fridays. Further, the ordinance changes the instances of Depot Street and Depot Ave. That is correct. Finally, on the fourth line of this table, you'll see that it eliminates a row. The row reads North Maple Street westerly, no time limit for 5 spaces, from 26 North Maple Street to 28 North Maple Street. I propose eliminating that because this is a table of limited time parking, and this says there is no limit. So that doesn't make sense to me. I thought we'd just clean that up. That is what the ordinance does. Ms. Forrest.
I would urge that particular item remain in here simply because that issue has come up time and again, whether or not there was supposed to be limited time parking there. And
and by being able to just pull up this ordinance and actually see that there is no time limit written down there, that it does help. It does help to make a good informed decision. Particularly with the number of businesses that are now using that building.
Okay. Thank you, that's helpful. First, is there a motion for a recommendation on this so we get on the floor? Is there a tinker with this?
Mm-hmm.
Councilor Klein makes a motion for a positive recommendation. Is there a second?
A second.
Okay, Mr. Hartwell seconds. And so Ms. Forrestal, I don't know.
Sorry, I jumped ahead there.
Oh, no, you didn't. Actually, as an advisor to the commission, your powers are limited. So I think what you propose makes sense, actually. So I will just move that we amend it so that item four is actually not stricken after all. That's I make that motion to amend. Is there a second for the motion?
That's the fourth box in the table, right?
Target.
Correct.
Okay. Issue.
Exactly, yes. Okay. Did you second it? I made the motion. Councilor Klein seconded the amendment. And the amendment is to not strike the fourth. Any discussion on the amendment? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. That amendment passes. Back to the regular order. Any other discussion on this ordinance as amended?
Avenue should
Mr. DPW.
Avenue should be spelled out.
Okay. Can we just take that as an amendment without objection? So, without objection, we're going to consider that has been changed to spell out Avenue in both cases.
Sorry, maybe could you just reiterate, Ryan, what is happening now that's a problem?
Oh, the only problem is that the ordinance doesn't reflect what the sign actually says. Last year, we took all the 15-minute spaces in the city, which had not been in the code of ordinances. They had just been established administratively in the past, and we, for the first time, codified them in Schedule 3. And this is just a minor inconsistency. Yeah, it was in there, but the time limit was not what the sign says. So that's all this really does. Okay. Any other discussion on this? Okay, so we have a motion on the floor for a positive recommendation. There's no other discussion. Ask for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Thank you very much. Item number 12, this is an ordinance for the purpose of eliminating the prohibition on parking in municipal lots longer than 24 hours. I'd accept a motion on this to start off with. Motion for positive recommendation. Anyone game for that? Sounds like we have to have a discussion about it first. So in that case, I'd ask Ms. Forrestal leave that discussion, or Mr. Pomerantz, since it kind of fell to you at the last minute.
The reason why I brought this forward is that what it says in the ordinance is not actually what is happening in our parking lots, because we have the long-term parking lots that you can actually buy up to 5 days of parking at. So if we're allowing people to purchase that much time, we shouldn't have a conflicting ordinance that says that you can't do it. And these lots are being constantly used by residents who are buying long-term parking permits, which allow them to park longer than 24 hours in these lots. We don't want to have people storing their cars here for months on end, but at the same time, having an ordinance on the record saying that you can't do what we're allowing it by policy to do isn't a common sense way of approaching this, as far as I'm concerned.
Buying a 5-day pass means stuffing the box with quarters. They're not going anywhere. They're just feeding it and getting it one ticket, then one shows a date 5 days later.
Right. Because that computer in that box knows to kick over the evening hours where you don't have to pay to park. So you just keep dumping dollar coins in there, quarters, and when you're done, press the button and you're going to get, people routinely buy 3 days at a time because they get on the bus and they go somewhere or they live here. They buy the long-term parking permits so that they can park next to their home. And I think that one of the things that came out in the parking study was to push people off of the street parking, prime street parking into the long-term parking lots. So why would we want to discourage people from doing that?
Just to add what Nancy said, we talked about this for a little bit, and the reason that I would support basically removing this from the ordinance at this point is also something that came out of the parking study and that is under discussion in the city now is the increase in Amtrak train service, longer term, what are we going to do as far as encouraging and guiding people where they park when they want to leave town on the train for 2, 3, 4 days? So that's more of a sort of a parking policy, economic development issue that's sort of tied into this as well. The point about warehousing your car in the long-term lots, the parking maintenance staff on a regular basis goes through and notes if there are cars that are being left there for excessive amounts of time. And sometimes they'll coordinate with PD to have that checked out. So it's kind of hard to warehouse your car there, but like Nancy said, you can certainly move in and buy 4 or 5 days worth of parking privileges in the long-term lots. So just something else to put out here.
Council.
Is this going to affect what we talked about a few meetings ago and then we tabled around parking in the lots when there's snow removal happening? And just I'm wondering how this will interact with that, the potential for us to discuss that in the future.
There's the ordinance with the parking bans would supersede any of the parking permits or people paying to park in a lot. The parking ban is you must remove your vehicle from city streets and city lots and move them to the Armory Street lot or the parking garage. So that is already on the books. That's already in effect by ordinance to protect us there.
What is, Ms. Pomerantz, maybe this is for you. What's the legal mechanism by which, actually it could be for a number of people, what's the legal mechanism by which we can remove someone who's warehousing their cars in the instance that we remove the 24-hour limit? You know, when is it, you know, how do we know it's okay to tow someone or to get somebody?
In some cases, we do a 72-hour notice, although I can't recall doing one in the parking lot recently, but residents call if a car is parked in front of their house for too long, we'll put a notice on, and then 72 hours later, if they haven't moved it, we can legally tow it. But I don't know how that would work in a parking lot. I guess we'd be legally covered as well, but.
Do you think perhaps you're acting here on state authorization, state power that you have? Maybe we don't know, but.
Yeah, I'm not sure what that calls us.
Under parking enforcement, we have called the PD over. It's not common.
Okay.
But we have called the PD over to put a 72-hour notice on vehicles down in this lot here, the roundhouse lot, a couple of times. Usually the person gets the notice, you need to move it.
Okay.
Parking enforcement will watch and bring to my attention that a vehicle is sitting there with a couple of flat tires, or it seems like somebody is living out of their car in a lot. So that gets the conversation going.
Okay.
But we would run the plate, make sure it's not stolen, try to contact the owner before we would do anything.
Great. Council? Council.
So then what's the ordinance that supports our ability to do that if we're saying here that we're eliminating prohibition on parking in municipal lots for long term?
I'm not sure what 72-hour notice falls under. It must be a state law that it falls under.
So are we, I'm just wondering if we're not creating contradictory language right there.
Well, to read the proposed ordinance, we would strike in its entirety, which is brief, section 312.49, 24-hour parking limit in municipal lots. No person shall allow, permit, or suffer any vehicle registered in his or her name to be parked in any municipal lot for a period of time longer than 24 hours. We just get rid of that. So currently it says 24 hours, it doesn't say 72 hours. So I wouldn't think the 72-hour notice authority flows from this ordinance, but I can't answer your question where the authority comes from. I would imagine it is a state law.
It's a state law. Chapter 9. I don't think it's a city ordinance.
And now it's complete.
So I'm still confused because if people can actually get 5 days worth of parking, but at the same time there's a state law that says that we can tow, so it's going to be a totally arbitrary decision about whether or not the police department is called to come in. Put the 72-hour notice on the car because essentially people can stay longer. I'm hearing that we want to encourage that on some level so people use the train and the bus. So it's just, it seems like we don't have consistency here.
But the drivers that have paid for 5 days put the ticket in the car and then it's easy to see that car is paid up. They would not be putting 72-hour notices in those cars.
Right. It's more of us. Like if someone called in, it's typically in front of someone's house and it looks like the vehicle's been abandoned for a period of time. Officers don't go out and randomly look for cars that have been there for a long time, you know, but they make notice it. But like I said, in a parking lot, it's kind of totally different. And it would be something that was pointed out to us as kind of a suspicious car.
These would be vehicles that have 3 or 4 tickets already issued to them for failure to have a paid park tag. They come to the attention of park enforcement because of that. You know, why is this car still here? It has 5 tickets on it. Is something going on? Calling the PD to investigate that. As Captain's saying, you know, is this a stolen vehicle? So it isn't arbitrary. It's that it's been brought to the attention of the PD or park enforcement who then pass it on to the PD. Something like that.
And if they did have the ticket in the window that they paid for parking, obviously it wouldn't do anything unless it was a stolen car or something like that. So.
Any other discussion on this? Is there a motion for a positive recommendation?
So.
Mr. Lovell makes a motion. Positive recommendation. Is there a second? Mr. Carlos seconds. Any further discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Thank you. Now, we're on to item 13. This is an ordinance for the purpose of prohibiting parking on Park Prospect Street, right in front of the Survival Center. And I would ask Mr. Pomerantz to introduce this ordinance.
So, we have a situation where, as you head west on Prospect Street from the Survival Center, Adair Place is your next right-hand turn into a residential area. There are no parking anytime with arrow signs from Adair Place heading back east towards the Survival Center. There is one residential driveway, and you can see in the picture attached with this ordinance proposal. It's about a 25-foot strip of curbing between the end of this residence and the beginning of the Survival Center driveway, where there is no signage. So people park all the time there, especially when the Survival Center is in business and operation. And you have a situation where you have both cars and delivery trucks coming in and out of the Survival Center driveway, as well as the back of the Survival Center is used by the Northampton Public School grounds crew on a daily basis. So they're bringing trailers with equipment, lawn mowers, et cetera, dump trucks, pickup trucks, in and out of the survival center as well. And the situation is now where somebody is parked at the curb there between that residence and the survival center driveway. Both cars, and trucks, including the grounds trucks, have to swing out into the opposite lane if they want to head west on Prospect Street because they have to clear whatever vehicles are parked there. So this would, ordinance change would put a no parking sign anytime on that strip of curbing between the end of the survival center driveway and the first residence as you head towards the Dare place.
And we have two photographs. Any discussion?
I looked at the Google Maps and I was a little confused by their wording, and I think that this, and seeing the photograph actually underscored my concern, and I think we're talking about the northerly side of Prospect Street, not the westerly side.
Oh, you were right, Gary. My apologies, yes.
Okay, because once you change that word to northerly, then the distance
easterly
is just to the center. Because it looked like that could be the western side and the eastern. Anyway, so if you agree, then I'm fine.
We'll catch you.
Thank you. I'd like to make an amendment to that change.
Well, first let's put it on
side.
First, let's have a motion for a positive recommendation.
Okay.
Mr. Palmer has moved positive recommendation. Is there a second?
Second.
Ms. Grenet? Grenet? She's, I'm sorry.
Grenet.
Ms. Grenet seconds. And now, Mr. Harwell, you make
a motion to just amend. Make one amendment that we change the word underside from westerly to northerly.
Okay. Mr. Harwell makes that amendment. Motion to amend. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. DPW, seconds. Mr. Hunt, seconds. And any discussion on the amendment? All in favor?
Aye.
All in favor of the amendment?
Okay.
Opposed? Now back to the regular order. Any other discussion? Ready for a vote? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Item 14 was an ordinance that has been withdrawn by the DPW. Item 15 is the ordinance that Councilor Klein referenced about prohibiting parking, municipal parking during snow emergencies. It was my task to talk to the mayor's office about it after last meeting. I don't really have any more information at this point to share. So I would actually move we postpone it again to the next meeting. Hopefully it won't snow anytime soon. So we have some time, but if that's okay with everybody. Okay, so let's just do it. Let's do the full motion. So I move to postpone to the next meeting. Is there a second for that?
Second.
Councilor Klein seconds the motion to postpone. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? I assume there was no need for discussion on that. Thank you. So now we have about, it's 20-6. And we have these discussion items. So as always, if you feel like you want to postpone some of these, feel free. Item number 16 is from Councilor Klein. It's a potential crosswalk to Kolodzinski Park across from the Florence Civic Center. Councilor?
This is something that I've already talked to Director Huntley about. The Ward 7 resident came to me and said, now that it's summer, kids are crossing the road to get to this little triangular parking from the Civic Center to sit by the fountain, play in the fountain, sit on the bench there. Older folks in the SROs across the street are crossing the street. There's no crosswalk, it's dangerous. What's the possibility of putting a crosswalk in there? So I just wanted to bring it up here and see if anybody had any strong feelings one way or the other. Is this some kind of recommendation that we need to make to the DPW, or do we need to create a new crosswalk? I don't even know, but I'm just curious to
Any discussion?
We can start off by having the conversations with Councilor Klein on this. We try to run on mid-block crossings wherever we possibly can. And one of the problems with that particular street is that the only place you could do where they actually have an intersection is the intersection of Meadow and Pine, actually Park Street rather, excuse me. There's an existing crosswalk from the VFW across the street towards the little library there. You could actually triangulate it and put a series of three crosswalks there. My concern is that cars coming off of Route 9 coming around that corner onto Park Street tend to travel a little bit quickly. Granted, there is a crosswalk there now, but is that going to be a hindrance? You're coming around the corner and can't see someone that might be crossing right there. I think the safest place for the crossing would be probably a mid-block crossing between the VFW and the, used to be a hairdresser shop there in the back on Shea's property, and have it come into the center of the park. Cars are really slowing down on Meadow Street as they're trying to merge onto Route 9 or to North Main Street. But like I said, I do frown on those, and maybe the best location is just a single crossing from the VFW across to the upper tip of the park across Meadow Street itself. So I can't see someone crossing Route 9 past the intersection or North Main Street. There's already a crosswalk there. So it's a matter of how we get them to the park. And I really don't know how many people use the park.
A fair number actually do. People sit on the bench. There is a bench there. And a lot of people go and sit on the fountain or get into the fountain.
Right. I'd really frown on it at the intersection of Park Street and North Main Street. Just too busy of an intersection for a crosswalk there where the existing stop bar is. We're coming out of Park Street trying to turn on Route 9. Way too busy there. So if we can do anything, we look at something on the back corner side towards the VFW as a single crossing.
That section, I guess, is essentially one way, right?
It is.
And the sight lines are pretty good, I think.
They're fairly open if you're paying attention.
Yeah.
I mean, part of the question for me is just procedurally how a new crosswalk is created, and if we need to, in fact, make a recommendation, if we need to, or if it's just an administrative decision by the DPW.
It's, in the past, it's been an administrative decision where we're going to place them. It's not by ordinance, it's not by the TPC, however, I appreciate their input into it, that's for sure. The other thing, if we do put a crosswalk in there, we'll have to invest some money into ADA compliance.
Okay. Any other discussion? It's a discussion item right now. Let's make a motion.
I'm sorry, I
think we
need to make a motion. It's an administrative.
Yeah, we would just not be taking any action.
Right. The big thing is that what I don't know is if can we actually get an ADA ramp in there with our city layout and the sidewalk that exists right now. That's what I don't know offhand. So we have to look at that.
Okay. Anything else on this item?
I mean, I guess I'd like to have a little bit more of a sense of how what the next step might.
I would have one of the engineers go out and look at it and evaluate it and see whether or not it can be done without some kind of land taking to create the handicap ramps coming across. So maybe that's maybe a chance for this project. Throw it to the wolves.
Okay. Anything else on this item? You ready to move on, Council? Okay. 17, number item 17 is yours as well. Traffic study from North Main Street in Florence. Update.
Yeah, just hoping to get an update about, because I know that things were laid out to measure speed and so forth, if there are any results.
We do. We did collect data, and I did not bring it with me tonight, but I'll be more than happy to share it for the next meeting. Not a problem. We want to in advance. Alex was able to do that. Alex Trump was able to do that before he left the last minute. It was done by Greeley Avenue, was where we put the counters in.
Any other discussion on this item? Item 18, purchase of additional electronic speed measurement signs. Council Klein.
I just wanted to check in about that, and I know that there's the one that the police department kind of has jurisdiction over that gets moved into the trailer, But if there's a need in the city, we're getting so many more traffic coming, applications, and I'm just wondering if it's something that we kind of need to bump up for next year to the, on the capital plan, the capital improvements plan for the city, if it would be useful for the city to have additional signs like that, whether they be these mobile ones that the police have jurisdiction over that the DPW can somehow move. So again, just for discussion here on the committee.
I'm not sure how we purchased that the speed trailer we have. It's just a radar, movable radar trailer that shows the speed. I don't think it counts, from my knowledge, any type of car numbering or anything like that. So I'm not sure how much those are going to cost or where we got the one we have from. But we can definitely use more.
Do we have a sense whether or not they're effective in actually slowing people down? Does it last beyond kind of the first time anybody traveling past it sees it? I mean, do we have any evidence that it's useful?
I think it, personally, I think it's useful. The residents, they call all the time wanting it on their property or on their street, and they find it helpful, and they really think it reduces the speed of the car speeding on the street. After someone sees it there the first time, they're going to work the next day. It may not affect them the second time around, but personally, I think it's a good thing. I think it's helpful. And we get a lot of requests for it from the citizens. I'm guessing that kind of expense.
Ms. Brennan?
Are the signs that are mounted permanently that flash the speed limits, are those, where do those come out of? Is that a DPW thing or?
The only ones that flash right now are the ones for school zones, which are just two flashing bulbs, 20 miles an hour during, I think it's an hour period of time before school and after school or towards the close of school each day. They do make signs. We looked at those when we were doing South Street traffic calming, and they were back then, I believe, $6,000 or $7,000 a piece for a stationary sign that would, you can program to flash only when they're above the speed limit, so they're not on all the time. I think I gave Councilor Klein an estimate of probably $9,000 to $10,000 by one now. That study was about 4 or 5 years ago. I'm sure they've gone up in price a little bit.
That's for the permanently mounted?
That's correct.
So if you're going 60 down on 45, it'll say 60?
Yeah.
Ms. Forrestal, and then Captain.
Is this a sort of item that would be out there for grant money? It would seem to me that this is a public safety issue that might.
I don't know of any grant money from behalf of Public Works. There might be something on highway safety from police. I don't really know.
Yeah, cash for jobs. We'll look into it.
Captain, is your comment?
Smith College has one or two up on Route 9 with solar powered ones, which are good, but I'm sure they're expensive as well. I'm not sure. I think they purchased them themselves.
They did. Those are advisory ones they have, even though the speed was 35. They haven't said 25 to fly to tell you.
It's an advisory.
Okay. That's why it's signed in yellow instead of white.
I installed that. It was a project that we did. It was part of the Elm Street pedestrian safety project. And it was about $5,000 for the sign. It is also, it does collect data.
That one is.
It does. No one's been able to figure out how to get the data out. You have to have a laptop and Bluetooth, and there have been issues with it. And it never worked right initially. I think it is working correctly now, but I've noticed that the lights are starting to go. So that went in prior to, that went in 2009, prior to the 2010 project.
Other discussion on this item?
I mean, again, I guess I'm just looking for input whether or not we think it's a useful tool that we should consider having this in the capital plan. We want another one or two, either movable ones or installing them in particular places around the city.
So I guess right now, as far as what's in the capital plan right now, there's actually traffic calming money in the plan. Whether or not this could be considered an option, would that be a traffic, you know, calming project is to buy another trailer for the police department. The intent was to really was to funnel that money into neighborhoods that don't have funding for traffic programs, themselves like State Street and a few others that have never been funded or moved upon. We can always put it in the capital plan for next year. That changes every year.
A worthy project, just to make a suggestion, might be if there's a number of these kind of goodies that we could recommend to the mayor as part of the, you know, the budget process for the upcoming year. So not just this sign, but if there's other things outside of traditional traffic calming that we're interested in seeing.
Capital booms will probably start up in late August, September again. It's on a very short track after the fiscal year starts. That's what happened last year.
One possible approach. Anything else for today?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Item number 19, unless there's, I'd like to, without objection, unless there's any objection, postpone this again to the next meeting. It's my item. It has to do with traffic calming applications for the Montague Henry Street neighborhood. One of the reasons I like to postpone it is we're also going to, I hope, discuss traffic calming mitigation money that we have for the neighborhood from various building projects over the years. And I'd like to bring that to the commission next month. So unless there's any objection, I'd like to postpone that. Okay, so that is postponed without objection. Item number 20, Mr. Lowenthal, Vision Zero Pedestrian Safety Program.
Vision Zero is a program started in Sweden some years ago that has spread around the world. The idea is roughly 1.2 million people die in traffic accidents worldwide. And for a number of reasons, that is generally perceived as acceptable. If that many people, if a small fraction of that number died in airplanes or trains or buses, we would be in uproar. And yet, when it's on the roads in so-called regular traffic crashes, we just see that as the regrettable cost of doing business. In the United States, the numbers have come down from 40,000 a year to 30,000 a year. And it's still an unbelievably high number. That's just the number of fatalities. It's around 200,000 very serious injuries per year in the United States. We're no stranger to that. All of us have friends who've been killed, neighbors have been killed, family members have been killed or maimed. We've all read about them in the newspaper. You cannot pick up the newspaper without seeing another story about another traffic fatality in our very own area, in our community. Vision Zero is a set of principles that says that's not acceptable. We should shoot for zero, and we should do what we can to shoot for zero. And the general principle is that people are always going to make mistakes. Every single crash we've heard about, the hordes of people we just had here today talking about Cook and Hatfield, every crash is the result of some mistake, some human error. The point of Vision Zero is to shift the responsibility from the individuals in the car, from saying, look, it was your fault, you made a mistake, now you pay for it with your life or by taking somebody else's life. And instead to say, it should be the responsibility of us who design and maintain the whole traffic system to assume that the mistakes are going to be made and to design and build and maintain a system that means when mistakes are made, you don't get a fatality. So that means calming traffic or changing traffic or changing behavior through the system. And so what does this mean on the ground basis? It might just mean traffic calming. It's not a prescriptive set of principles to say you have to do it this way, you have to do it that way. But cities are piling on to Vision Zero. New York City is a member of the Vision Zero Initiative. San Francisco is a member of the Vision Zero Initiative. At the recent bicycle summit in Washington, D.C., there was a whole workshop devoted to Vision Zero to help representatives from cities around the country to learn about Vision Zero and to adopt those principles and initiatives. So I propose that the TPC should ask the mayor to make it official that Northampton believes in the principles that no fatality or serious injury is acceptable, and that the city should strive through the Vision Zero initiative to reduce with an aim towards zero those numbers.
Thank you very much. Any comments? My comment would be it's something that maybe we could consider putting into a resolution that originates from this commission. That in fact goes through the council, which makes calls for this endorsement of these principles.
Is this initiative on the website that we can read up on?
Yes.
Learn about it.
Yes, there's lots on visionzeroinitiative.org, I think is one.
Yep. There are numbers.
I think it's, you know, I think it's extremely worthy to discuss. I don't think it's just a rhetorical device. I think it helps frame our efforts. And insofar as that's our job in the Transportation and Parking Commission, I think that would be completely appropriate and useful and useful signal to send to the community and get them thinking about this.
And I should add that I'm not the first to bring it up. I think Councilor Kleins brought it up. I think you brought it up yourself, Councilor. Anyway, I know we've discussed it before, but I think we should make it official.
Okay.
I know we don't have much time, but I guess my concern is that I wouldn't want us to, you know, write a resolution for it to be really just a rhetorical kind of device. And I'm really curious about, you know, if there are any kind of parameters at all, if you're going to sign up to be a Vision Zero city, what does it mean you have to do? Are there things you have to do? If there aren't, how do we make it not just a rhetorical device? Because I think that's actually more of an insult to our citizens if we're putting something in place, you know, just to feel good about it without it having any teeth behind it. So I need to study up more on it and just kind of see so that we're not just doing a feel-good measure.
Okay. Any other discussion for this meeting? So do you want to tackle item 21?
Yes, thanks. And I should just point out that this is my last TPC meeting. I'm moving out of the city for 1 year, just temporarily coming back. But I've been on the TPC almost the entire time it's existed. I helped found it. I helped found the traffic calming program and many other elements. It's been great working with you all, but it's time for me to step down and make room for somebody else, especially since I'll be going to TPC. So with that, my favorite thing that could possibly come out of the next year would be for me to come back and see that progress has really been made in, on the ground in implementing traffic calming programs. And as we all know, last year for the first time and then this year for the second time, money was set aside in the mayor's capital improvements budget specifically for traffic calming. And we all know that the DPW has been plagued by departures of the traffic engineers to MassDOT. My question for Ned Huntley would be, well, how are we going to keep, Maggie Chan on board and keep her from getting poached by the DOT like everybody else, like Laura Hansen announced a little bit before her. I think it's a real shame that we have more than two dozen traffic calming requests that the city has agreed are worth implementing. And yet, we're accruing them at a much faster rate than we're actually dealing with them. It's unsustainable. And I think we have to prioritize that, I think, higher as a city, as a community. We've inherited a system that prioritizes moving traffic through, moving cars at high speed and high volume. And I think everything we hear again and again, month after month, is that the citizens want a different priority. They want to prioritize quality of life, safety, access for bicyclists and pedestrians. All of those come through the traffic calming program, and I think we really, really, as a community, as a city, and as a commission, need to focus our efforts on moving some of those out of the pipeline instead of just stuffing the pipeline full. So,
okay. Comments on that?
Yeah. I'd like to thank you for your commitment to this committee for so long, the mission for so long, and all of the great work that you brought to it. Thank you for your inspiring speech.
Yes. Yeah, thank you.
NASA?
No. Montreal. Yeah, I'm not going to space.
Yeah, if I could pile on, I think, you know, what you just said is a reminder of how lucky we were to have you on this commission. Obviously, well predating me being on it, Councilor Klein or others, and I think that Northampton owes you a lot for your work here, and also I expect that when you come back from Montreal, you'll find a way to be involved in civic life again, and we're all very fortunate that you have that commitment and are willing to do that.
Thank you, Senator.
Then we should change the traffic calming procedure to, we should call it the James Lowenthal traffic calming procedure.
David Arbolis deserves that. That helps.
Well, we'll give you the honor of making, unless there's any new business, I'd like to extend the honor to you.
Move to adjourn.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.